Okay,
Yes, sir. Visible.
we will start. So what we are going to do is actually, I think there are two handouts that have been loaded in the portal. So we'll cover this chapter 4 first, and then we'll get on to this chapter 3, which is on accounting concepts, right? So last week, as you know, we went through the accounting process, or rather the framework for reporting. And in that, we looked at various factors. Then we also identified what is the fundamental equation that is the accounting equation. So we saw that assets equals liabilities plus equity. This is the fundamental accounting equation, very important, which you have to remember, because in examination they might give you various versions. Even though this is the broader equation, you can have multiple versions of this equation as part of your questions. So for example, there could be if you had seen a paper, the question number 2. Question number 2 is, has been so far, it is a multiple choice question, or rather short notes, right? It's a combination of multiple choice and short notes. So in that, you might see these type of questions where it is tested at several times. So, and we also went on to look at what is the expanded accounting equation, where it says liabilities plus capital plus income minus expense minus dividend. So we call this as the expanded accounting equation. And also we said this is what you are, what is this? What is this component? What do we call this component? Yes? It will be your retained earnings. So what do you mean by retained earnings is where you earn profit for a particular year.
Sir, body slip. You can't see it properly. Body slip.
Okay. Hold on. I'm told that. Now is it okay? Can you see it now?
Yes, now it's clear.
Okay. Right. So this component or this element is known as the retained earnings of your books. Say for example, a company which is set up in the year of 2000, let's say, so they have earned some profit. Likewise, they come to 2020. So every year, what would have happened? They would have earned a profit. They would have distributed part of it as dividends to the shareholders, and there must be a remaining. So every year, the remaining is added to the subsequent year. So 2001, 2, likewise, you come up to 2020. So when you reach this particular year, now you have a profit here, which is added every year. This is what we know as, call as the retained earnings, okay? Then we also looked at what are the types of assets, what are liabilities, and what are the elements of equity. Then I also went on to give you all an idea about the four types of costs that we make use of in accounting. So we had historical cost, current cost, then we had the net realizable, and finally we had the present value. So did you all go and get the definitions? I wanted you all to get the definitions. Did you all do it? Can someone give me a definition for current, sorry, historical cost? What about historical cost? Anyone? I wanted you all to find out. Any idea? No idea. Right, so I'll give you one more week and I hope you all go and get the definition for me. Okay, right. So please ensure that you somehow search it in the Google and get the definition for the four types of costs. Right, some of you have sent me the definition. That's good. So you all can. Right, so let's get on to the topic today, which we call it as accounting process. Accounting process. I'll come to the accounting concepts after that. So we'll start off with the accounting process. Right, so now we have started. We have gone through like what are the companies, what are the types of companies, their advantages, disadvantages, and then who are the users of financial information and how do we call them, right? So many things we have gone through. So today we are going to look at how does the accounting process works, or what should a company must do when you are, they are doing the accounting function, right? So broadly, we know in accounting, there are three branches. There are three main branches, right? So we call them as financial accounting, management and we talk about financial accounting, management accounting and cost accounting. These are the broader categories of accounting. But for your exam purposes, what we are focused here is about financial accounting. So you don't need to worry about any other type of accounting that is available. What our focus will be on financial accounting, right? So when you say financial accounting, what does it mean? It provides historical financial information about the organization. So end of the day, whatever the business is, we want to evaluate how the company has performed. How the company has performed. That is in terms of rupees and cents. Now, since we are in Sri Lanka, we talk about them in rupees and cents. But in a company which is established in US, might talk about the financial information in terms of US dollars. US dollars. So when it comes to Sri Lanka, we talk about the company's financial performance in terms of rupees and cents. But what is more important in this is, in financial accounting, we will be talking about the history. In the past, what has happened to this company in the past? So when I say past, if you are today, and today being, let's say, assume it's a business day. So yesterday is history. Yesterday is history anyway. Because financial accounting is always looks backwards. What happened to this company yesterday? What happened to this organization last month? What was it 6 months back or last year? So financial accounting has been always looking at things in the history. So that is why financial reporting, in order to do financial reporting, we need to close our books. The business or operations of a business has to close down on a particular day, and then only you look at what the company has performed. But when it comes to the management accounting, that is more of a futuristic accounting method. It does not always look at the history, but it also looks at the future. So it provides the information that is required for internal planning, decision making, and also for controlling purposes. So management accounting is more or less a combination of financial accounting, which is talking about the history, and also it's more or less part of the management accounting is to look at the future. Now, how does this happen? When you want to do planning, planning means how the business should be taken forward in the coming years. What sort of activities should I take? Now, generally in businesses or in banks, we call this as preparation of the corporate plan or the budget. How the bank should run in the next 5 years. What are the activities they should do in the next year to make a better performance? So every company looks at preparing a budget which is for its internal purposes. You don't provide it for outside. But when it comes to financial accounting, it is always where even though you prepare it for yourself, but there is a most important obligation that you need to provide to outsiders. That is where publication of financial statements comes first. Management accounting also looks at the control aspect. When I say control aspect, how the company should be managed, how the company should be managed. In most of the cases, what happens, the companies might want to focus more on their activities in terms of costs. So you might have heard this word, cost cutting. What do you mean by cost cutting? Cost cutting is actually how to contain your costs or expenses. Now, in order to contain your expenses, you need to know certain information which will be useful for you to make the decisions. So management accounting is a combination of internal planning, which is based on historical information. Then you will provide them some futuristic information for decision purposes, and also some information which are of course historical and a combination of futuristic for controlling purposes. Right? And the last type of accounting is, we call it as cost accounting, which is more or less to do with the goods and also at times services. We are talking about cost details of goods and services. So we have to be mindful that even though there are three branches of accounting here, our focus will be on financial accounting. So throughout this course, we will be looking at financial accounting. The other two branches of accounting is not our focus. So, the importance of accounting. The importance of accounting. Accounting is looked at as a social phenomenon because investors are very keen to invest more and more in profitable businesses. Now, why should an investor come and invest money if that business is making losses? They are not very keen to do that. So when will you have more and more investors coming in is when you do or make better profits or when you display better performances. Secondly, it is looked at as a source of information. Accounting helps to provide the important information not only to the third parties, as I told you, the shareholder, the outside, the general public, the government, everybody. It also provides information to the management because the management is answerable to whatever that happens within the organization. So the management also should know details or information about the organization. Then, as I told you earlier, it is also a mean of control. A mean of control means it provides information relating to income and expenses or assets and liabilities to the management to direct and control the resources. Now, say for example, there is a reduction in income. So the management should know why all of a sudden the income has reduced. Aren't we producing enough goods? Aren't we providing adequate services for the income to come down? Then on the other side, there could be an escalation of expenses. The expenses might rise. So the company has to look into how can they curtail the expenses. So that is where the salary reduction, so many things can happen. Even during this COVID pandemic, you would have seen a lot of companies have retrenchers, they have suspended staff or rather than redundant, they made redundant staff redundant. So a lot of things have happened during this time period. So what is more important for us to know is how do we measure all these using the accounting or the information provided through accounting to monitor and control these financial information. Okay. Right. So the accounting process actually goes through three phases. Right? How do we categorize this? You know, you would have seen, if I ask you a process in a computer, how it works, it only goes through these three steps. There is an input, there is a processing, and there is output. So here also, what is the input? You get the transactions and events. Then there is an accounting function happens. And finally, you get the output, which is your company's financial statements. So let me give you a simple example where we try to understand how this happens in our banks. Now let's say a customer comes to your bank with 10,000 rupees of money or cash. And he wants this to be deposited. So you know what is depositing means. So he wants this to be deposited. So this is the transaction, or you can call it as the event where the customer coming to the bank and requesting the bank to deposit rupees 10,000 in his name, or maybe to some other party. It could be anything. Now the bank accepts this transaction. So the next step is they have to process. So what do? They make use of the computer system that they have in the bank. Now today, in today's context, you know that almost all the banks have computer systems. So all the banks are today computerized. So any transaction that they do it via their computer system. So the teller, or the front-end staff member who is there, will be, who is seated there at the counter, will process this transaction in their system. Right? Now, after processing, what happens? There will be a receipt which is given to the customer for the confirmation of the deposit. Then internally, there is the counting. Now this produces the required financial information. So that is how it happens. Look how the transaction originates, or the event originates, how it gets processed, and where it reaches. It gives you an output where the customer will collect the receipt, deposit slip, the counter foil, and go for his record purposes. Bank will retain one portion of it, and then they will do the accounting pertaining to this particular transaction. Okay, so that is about the accounting process. Right. Okay, so there is actually three steps where you give the input, which is the transaction or event, then you process it, and then you get the output. So, as I told you, the transactions can be broken into two types. We call them internal, and the other being the external. Business activities can be described in terms of the transactions that are both internal and external. And on the other side, you also have events, which are again internal, or it could be external. External transactions are exchanges of values between two entities, which yield a change in the accounting equation. Now, see, This is very important. What do you mean by an external transaction? External transaction means a transaction that can happen between two entities. When you say two entities, it could be two companies, or it could be between a company and an individual. But generally we call it as, whether it is a company or an individual, we call it as entity. Later on you will learn that why you call it as an entity. Entity is actually looked at as a counterpart. It's the counterparty that you are transacting with. So the result of which is a change in the accounting equation. Now you recall the accounting equation. What is the accounting equation? Assets equals liabilities plus equity. So what does the effect of transactions will be is there is a change which is going to be there in the accounting equation. Either assets might go down, liabilities might go down, anything can happen. We don't know. Right? So the function is to do the accounting part of it. To do the accounting part of it. That is why we are here, to learn the accounting. Internal transactions are exchanges within any entity. They can also affect the accounting equation. Now it's not only the external transaction, but there are internal transactions as well. How does this internal transactions work? It could be within the organization. It could be within the organization. From the marketing department, it is to the selling and distribution. Okay. From the finance unit to the administration unit. It could be any transaction that you can perform. Events are which refer happenings that affect an entity's accounting equation, which cannot be reliably measured. So other than the monetary value transactions that we are talking about, there could be so much of transactions. Sometimes these are not reliably measured. So those type of transactions also, we call them as, with a special name, as events. Now let me give you an example. Let's say one of the properties of an organization caused fire. Now due to this fire, the damage could be very much. But the problem here will be, you may not be able to quantify correctly the cost of the damage. But still, that particular event of catching fire can have an impact on your company's assets, liabilities, or equity. That is very, very important. You need to remember that. Now, this structure, of course, you don't need to memorize this. Just try to understand. Can you go through this first by yourself? I'll give you about 2 minutes. Now I have shown the arrow marks. So go in that particular direction and see what do they say. So, what did you see? Now, when you observe the entity's operation, it starts with a function call where you identify the transactions and events. Now, say if in a bank, I always take the example of a bank, which is easy for me to explain. So if you look at a bank, now in a particular day, there are hundreds of customers coming to your bank. Okay, there are hundreds of customers coming to your bank. Now, why are they coming? They are coming for various purposes. 20 people of them will come to deposit money. Another 10 might come to withdraw money. Another 10 might come to ask for loans. Another 10 might come for asking for just for information. So you might get transactions and events happening on a particular day. So the first thing that we need to do is we need to identify these transactions. When a customer enters the bank through the door, we need to identify for what type of a transaction that this customer has come. That is the identification. Then you need to classify the transaction. Now, say for example, generally I have not seen, is there any bank which is offering the pawning facilities when you straight away enter into the bank counter? No. Generally, the bank front counter staff will do transactions relating to accepting deposits or withdrawals or maybe account opening. Those are the fundamental functions that they do. Pawning, offering pawning facilities could be another separate function which will be handled by a separate unit. So now, after identification of the transaction, you need to classify the transaction. After classification, there is a function called recording it in the primary books. If you have a handout in your hand, please underline the word primary books. We will be looking at it separately. That will be our probably fifth or sixth topic. So we will look into it, what primary books are, how the transactions are recorded there, right? So that is the next step of accounting process. Once you have entered in the primary book, you do the accounting for the transaction. Once the transactions are accounted, now you come to an important situation or the step where you want to start preparing your financial statement, because that is what the ultimate objective is. So where do you start preparing your financial statements? That is by extracting a trial balance. We call it as a trial balance. Underline the word trial balance. So trial balance is a very important tool for the organization to prepare financial statements. Okay. And from an exam perspective, if you look at it, the question number one in your paper, which is the compulsory question, is actually targeting on from this step onwards. That is, you might be given a trial balance, or you might be requested to draw up a trial balance. So you have to be very thorough with this, extracting a trial balance or maybe drawing up a trial balance. And thereafter, we get the adjusted trial balance, prepare the financial statements, you will do any adjustments, and then taking the balances to the next year, because company's performances are evaluated year on year. What happened last year, what happened this year, likewise. So once the accounting process is done, that is the identification, classification, and then recording, how do we record it? So for recording transactions, there is a principle. There is a principle which we call it as the double entry principle or the double entry system. Double entry principle or the double entry system. What happens there? The business transactions will have two aspects. The business transactions will have two aspects. What are the two aspects? We call them as debit and credit. Very important. These two terms will go forever. If you are looking into an accounting or maybe any subject, you can't avoid these two terms, the word debit and the word credit. That you will hear from now onwards in this module, as well as you would have already heard this term in your respective organizations. Unless you are serving as we call it as non-essential services, which are like posting transactions, doing the accepting deposits and giving loans, those type of transactions. Leaving out those, if you are doing a support function, normally you might not see this. But other than that, debit and the term credit is a fundamental. A system of accounting where both aspects of each transaction are recorded is prescribed rules is called double entry system. Double entry system. So what is double entry system? Right. So, now you do the accounting, it follows a principle. It follows a principle. What do we say here? We call it as the double entry principle. Double entry principle. The result of the double entry principle is where you will have a debit and a credit. Debit and a credit. So what is so special about this is the debit will be known as, or rather we'll start with credit. The term credit means it is denoted as CR. What do you mean by CR? It is actually taken from here. Okay. So when you say credit as CR, automatically we call the debit to be ER. It is not the term that we use for doctor, but this is known as the debit. So don't ask me how come on earth it is going to be known as DR. Whereas we don't see any R in this. Okay. that you have to ask from Mr. Luca Pacioli. I think I gave you a slide last time. So he is the person who has to answer that question, right? So when it comes to the double entry principle, we have to think about what is the debit and what is the credit. Okay, what is the debit and what is the credit? Now the entire accounting system is going to evolve around this concept of debit and credit. So we will be talking a lot about these debits and credits. How you draw up these debits and credits for the next 4 to 5 months. Okay. So if you want, you can just state down this for your record purposes. Okay, so the double entry system is going to do a important function. What is that? That is to keep the accounting equation always in balance. Always in balance. So what do you mean by that? You write an equation which is known as the accounting equation, in which you say assets are equal to liabilities plus equity. Assets are equal to liabilities plus equity. Now this equation will stand forever as long as the double entry principle is followed by a company. If you are following the double entry principle properly, then of course you are going to have this accounting equation always as correct. Okay, so it's very important that you follow the double entry system or the double entry principle properly to ensure or to keep the accounting equation always in balance. Okay. Now we are going to look at, we are talking about account over again. So what is this account is all about? Account is all about, right? So let me explain it on the board. So the accounting equation or the account, I will derive it from this. Right? Assets equals liabilities plus equity. I can have anything from this equation towards this side. Similarly, I can have anything from this equation towards this side. So I have a left side and I have a right side. Okay. Now this is the fundamental for the structure of an account. For the structure of an account. Now how do we say this? We draw a horizontal line and we divide it at the middle. Now I will have a left side and a right side. And this is divided by a vertical line like this. So make these into two pieces. Right? Now when you look at this structure, what does it resembles you? It is somewhat similar to the English letter that you know, which is the capital T. The capital T. So when you look at an accounting structure or the account structure, it resembles the letter T. As a result, we generally call these as T accounts. T accounts. We call them as T accounts. So going forward, I will make use of the term T accounts. When I say T account, you should know what is T account is. What is T account is. So T account means actually, it talks about the structure of the account. Structure of the account. But when a customer visits your bank, can you say, I'm going to offer you a T account? No, it doesn't make sense. The customer doesn't want what is your T account is. Not relevant. Customer wants to know what is his account number is. If he is going to have a savings account, what is his number? Current account, what is his number? If he is going to have a deposit, what is the deposit account number? Or if you are giving a loan to a customer, he would like to know what is the loan account number. They don't want to understand all this. But having said that, for accounting function to be perfect, we need this T account. We need this T account. So what do you get this? Or what do you get here? Now there is a T structure, there is a left side and a right side, and we need to have a name for this account. So you might write something on top of this horizontal line to indicate the account name. We call this as account title. Account title. You can call it as account name also. There is no issue. But generally we call it as account title. Now only we come to the most important element of this account. Right? Now we spoke about a double entry. The double entry principle. Where we talk about a debit and a credit. So, the left side of the account is known as the debit side. The left side of the account is known as the debit side. Please remember these for those who doesn't know anything on accounting, but people who know might already understand this. The right side of the account is known as the credit side. The credit side. So these are like two bags. Here there is a bag or a basket. Here there is a basket. Now whatever that you put into this basket on this side it is going to be called as a limit. Whatever that you are going to put into this basket, it is going to be called as a. But end of the day, when you pool both together, that is your account. That is your account. So this has to be very clearly understood. So there was an announcement actually coming Wednesday, that is on 21st Wednesday. They are going to have a class, additional class. The IBSL has arranged it for all subjects. I mean, so you will have the normal accounting class also at 3:30, I think, the normal time. So you will have that class. They will send you a notification, right? Please make a note. That is coming Wednesday, 21st. Right, so I think 21st and 23rd, the entire 2 days, they are going to have classes for all the subjects. So business accounting will be there on Wednesday, 21st at 3:30. Right, coming back to this point. So you have two baskets. One is a debit basket and one is a credit basket. The combination of these two is your account. Right? And your account will be throwing up a balance also. Without the balance, we can't do anything. So you should have account balances to prepare financial statements. You need to have account balances to prepare financial statements. Okay? So please take down this. Okay, so you have a T account here, you have the account title, you have a left side which is known as the debit, right side as the credit. Whatever you put on this side is known as a debit, whatever that you put on this side is a credit. So which means ultimately you will have a debit balance, we call it as a debit balance, also a credit balance. So what do you mean by account balance is the combination of the two. Combination of the two. Now from here we are going and relate these to here. Right? Now taking this account structure into our mind, let us focus on the accounting equation. Right? Are you all with me? Okay, you all can see the board, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So now from this account structure, we are going to relate it to the accounting equation. Now see, here also you will see something similar to that. There is a left side and a right side. There is an equal sign. Right? So whatever on this side is going to form a debit. Whatever on left side of the accounting equation is going to form a debit balance, an amount. Whatever that is on the right side is going to form a credit balance. So that is why we say that debits should be equal to credit. Do you all understand that? Why we say this debit should be equal to credit is because of this. We have the accounting equation at the core. That is the left side and the right side. Left side can be related to this, where it should be then debit. The right side is related to this, which is the credit. And on the middle, you have the equal sign, which means the debits have to be equal to them. Okay? Have you understood up to now? I'm going little slow because this is the basic. Okay? There may be students who would have already know all this stuff. Please bear with me, because I have to go this journey very slowly. There may be candidates who might not know all these. If you don't get this fundamental basis correct, then you might find it very difficult later on. Okay? So it is very important that you get this basics right. Okay? Right. I hope you would have taken down. So let's get back to the presentation. Right, so this is the T account structure, and you see there is a left side and the right side, and you will have the debit and the credit on this. So an account is an individual accounting record of increases and decreases in a specific asset, liability, or owner's equity. So when we want to record the increases and decreases in an account, what do? We will try to establish this account, and that is how we are going to reflect all increases, decreases in asset, liability, and equity. An entity must have separate account for each item, such as cash, salaries, expenses, accounts payable, etc. Now, last week you would have seen there was a slide where there were several items given as assets, several liabilities, equity items, income, expense, and so on. So all those will always represent an individual account, So what we are talking about here is mostly nothing to do with the customer accounts, okay? If in your bank, you might have customer accounts also. Now we are not bothered about the customer accounts here. We are talking about the internal accounts of an organization. So as I told you, the simplest form of an account consists of the account title, left side, and the right side. Okay? So basically, we will have five types of accounts. As you all know, there could be asset accounts, liability accounts, capital accounts, income accounts, and expense accounts. Right. So, now what we are going to look at is something different. Right. So you can refer the remaining slides, but I'm going to explain them on the board. So you can look at the board and try to understand this. Okay. So please try to understand this properly. This is very important. Okay, right. Now we have the counting equation. Liabilities plus equity. And we have the T account. We have the T account. So this is your left side, or rather the debit side. This is your credit side. Now what I am going to do is, I am going to put some balances into this. Okay. So for example, I am going to take an account. You know, this is the very basic fundamental account that you can use, which is known as the cash account. Anything that is I have as money, physical money, is my cash account. We call it as the cash account. So now in my cash account, what would I do? I can do two things. One is I can put more and more debits into this. Okay, let's say I'm going to put some debits. 100, 150, 120, 230, just some numbers. Don't worry about the quantities. Similarly, I'm going to put some credits. 75, 35, 25, and 15. That's it. Right. Now we take a total. You take a total. Right. Now when you take a total of this side, how much is it? I think it is 600. Okay. How much is it on that side? Am I correct? Okay. So now look at this. One side is having 600, the other side is having 150. Which side is more? Your left side is more. Left side is more by how much? Left side is more by 450. Do you agree with me? Do you agree with this point? The left side is more by 450. 450. So, my argument here is that the balance of this account is 450. The balance of this account is 450. Do you all get that point? That is very important. Left side you have 600. Right side you have 150. So left side is debit, right side is credit. Now end of the day when I look at it, this side is more. Because this side is more, and I need to see by how much it is more. It is more by 450. So when it is more by 450, that is known as the balance of this. Balance of this. Okay, quickly take down this. Thank you. Okay, so where the balance is more, that is known as the account balance. Please remember, it is not the 600, it is not the 150, it is the difference between the two. Okay, it is the difference between the. Later on, we will try to understand how this balancing and those stuff is done. Right? Right? How it is done. Right. Now, when an account has a balance like this, that is known as the account balance. We call it as the account balance. Right. Now you have a point here. When the balance of the account is more on the left side, that is normally a debit balance. Do you understand that? When the balance in the account is more on the left side, that is a debit balance. If the balance is more on the right side, that is a credit balance. That is a credit balance. Now, take this into here. What can you say? What can you say? The left side of the equation will have a debit balance. The right side of the equation will have a credit balance. That is how the accounting equation balances. Okay? The left side and the right side. So the left side is going to take a debit balance. The right side is going to take a credit balance. A credit balance. Now look at what is going to happen based on that. Based on that. Right. Now, if your left side is a debit balance, means your assets will have a debit balance. Your assets will have a debit balance. Your liabilities will have a credit balance. Your liabilities will have a credit balance. What else you have? Equity. We call it as equity. So when you say equity, now comes the expanded equation. Expanded equation. Now equity, you know how it can be written. It can be written as capital plus income minus expense. Minus expense. So now we say this entire thing has to be credited. So now let us take individual. Capital is a credit balance. Income, again it is positive. So credit balance. But expense. Expense is a negative. Is a negative. So negative of credit means, negative of credit means that will turn into a debit balance. That will turn into a debit balance. Okay. Now this is like the mantra. This is like the mantra. Assets means debit balance. Expense means debit balance. Rest of the things are credit balance. So when I say mantra means you have to remember. Right? I won't say that you have to memorize this, but you have to remember this. Which means you have to remember this forever. Assets and expense will be debit balance. Liabilities, capital, income will be credit balance. And this is what known as the normal balance. Normal balance. So, the normal balance of assets is always debit. The normal balance of assets is always debit. But it doesn't need not be always debit. So you have to remember, depending on the transactions, if the balance of the account could be debit or credit, we don't mind. But here, when you say the normal balance of assets will be debit. The normal balance of expenses is also debit. The normal balance of liabilities, capital, income is all. Okay. This is very, very important. You have to remember. You have to remember. That is the must. Okay. So please take down. And thereafter you have to write a note. Below that you can take down, as shown above, the normal balances. As shown above, the normal balances in the above type of accounts. Will be either a debit, either a debit or a credit balance, or a credit balance. However, there could be situations these could turn around. In such instances, it will totally depend on it will be totally depend on the number of transactions or the type of transactions that are in the account. So now in the earlier example I showed you, there were 5 debits and there were 4 or 5 credits. End of the day the balance was 450. But depending on the situation, these can change. Right, now try to understand this. Now let's say this is an asset account. So what is the normal balance? The normal balance is a debit. You know that normal balance is a debit. If I go and increase more debits into this, put more debits into this account, what will happen to the asset balance? What will happen to the asset balance? Yes?
Increase?
It will increase. You see, this side will go up. So what happens to your normal balance? It will increase. Do you understand that? So in an asset account, the normal balance is a debit balance. Into that account, when you go and put more and more debits, I'm going to go put more and more debits into this. So which means my account will go up with that debit balance. Okay. So what you need to remember is in an asset account, in an asset account, more debits will increase the normal balance. Right? In an asset account, when you put more and more credits, what will happen? Now this is an asset account. I am going to put more and more credits. What will happen? When you put more and more credits, it will reduce the normal balance. That is what you have to remember. Right? In an asset account, when you put more and more debits, it will increase the normal balance. But to an asset account, when you put more and more credits, you go and put more and more credits into this, what will happen? It will bring down the normal balance. So what will happen here? When you put more debits, this will go up. When you put more credits, it will go down. Do you understand that? So to an asset, if it is an asset account, when you put more and more debits, the balance will go up. To an asset account, when you put more and more credits, it will come down. Now let us try to understand liability. Liability, the normal balance is a credit. Now, if you want to increase the liability account balance, if I want to increase this, what should I do? I want to increase the liability account balance.
Increase the credit side.
That means put more credits. Very simple. Put more credits. If I want to reduce it, You have to put more debits. Okay. So, what does it mean ultimately? You can show it with the diagram. Now let's say this is the balance level. So your asset will have a debit balance. If you want to increase that level, what do you need to do? Put more debits. If you want to bring down this level, put more. Very simple. Put more credits. Okay. We are talking about the normal balance. Normal balance. Right. Similarly, liability. Normal balance is a credit. If you want to raise this level, what will you do? Put more credits. Put more credits. If you want to bring down this level, normal balance level, put more debits. Very simple. Put more. So I am talking from the point of view of the normal balance. Normal balance is already what it is by nature. Can you break down this, please? For assets, this is the normal balance. If you put more and more debits, the balance will go up. If you put more and more credits, the balance will come down. In the case of a liability, normal balance is a credit. When you put more and more credits, the liability balance will go up. If you put more and more debits, it will come down. Quickly take down. Right. So your homework will be, I want you to write or the put down diagrams like this for equity, income and expense. Okay. So you are going to do that. You are going to put down three more diagrams. What will it be for equity or capital, for income and for expense, for income and expense. Okay, right. Any questions? Anything that you want to clarify? Because we are going to go into the next chapter. Anything that you want to clarify? No questions. Okay. Can we go to the next? Can you see the handout? The presentation?
Yes, sir.
Right. So let's go to the next chapter, which is actually the chapter 3. Why I wanted you all to look at chapter 4 is I just wanted to finish off the related section on the accounting equation and the normal balance, the double entry system. So that's why I just took it together. Now let's move on with the accounting concepts, right? So accounting concepts, of course, is an area where it is more theoretical, but that will form the basis for our understanding of accounting, right? You are not going to, you are not going to apply this in your accounting, rather than you will choose which concept to be used, right? But more importantly, what you need to know is how you will, interpret this and write the definitions in simple terms. Because in examination, what is mostly asked is to write down the definition, right? So you need to know how to write the definition. So that is why this becomes important as far as your examination is concerned, right? So what is accounting concept? The main objective is to maintain uniformity and consistency in accounting records, so which we have already looked at. We wanted every company, every individual, when they are preparing financial statements, we wanted them to be maintaining it uniformly across companies. Otherwise, what will happen? One person will do it in one way, the other person will do it in another way. That becomes a problem, right? So we want everybody to follow the same principles so that the financial statements are comparable. You can compare one with the other. So in order to facilitate this, we already know we have the Sri Lanka accounting standards, But on top of these standards, we have three more elements. We call them as basic accounting assumptions, accounting rules, and accounting conventions. Okay, there are accounting assumptions, accounting rules, and accounting conventions. All three fall under the single umbrella of accounting concept. The first such concept is, which is coming under accounting assumptions, called the business entity concept. So what does it say? It assumes that for accounting purposes, the business enterprise and its owners are two separate independent entities. Thus, the business and the personal transactions of its owner are separate. Now, this is one of the important concepts that you need to know. Right? What does it say? Now, in accounting, So you have the company here. The company. Generally, what happens? This company is set up with the money that is given by the shareholders. Given by the shareholder, right? Now let us look at a company. And let's say this is Mr. X, right? Now this is his company. He only has put money. Let's say he has put 10 million. He has put 10 million. So Mr. X has put 10 million and he has started this company. Let's say X Enterprises. Just for right now, let's say this is a grocery, simple shop, a grocery shop. So this 10 million is given by this person, Mr. So he has set up this company. Now this company is run and that company makes profits. End of the day, that profits are, or the profits belong to Mr. X, all that is fine, and he is running the business well. Right? Now, one fine day, he gets a call from home where his spouse or the wife wants him to bring down some stationary items. Stationary items for personal use. For personal use. So, what should this person do on his way home? He should stop at a shop and buy these whatever the stationary items and go home. But since it was a very bad day for him, what did he do? He goes and picks some stationery items from the shop, from his shop. The value of these stationery items, let's say rupees 7,000, very small amount. So he picks stationery items from his own grocery, 7,000 rupees worth stationery, takes it and gives it to his spouse. Now you tell me whether he can do this is the first question. Is it permitted for him to do this? What do you think? Is he permitted to do this? What do you think?
No. No.
Yes or no?
No.
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 Anybody saying yes? Anyone saying yes? If you say yes, I want a reason why you say yes. Anyone? You need to speak out, then only you will understand these concepts practically. Okay? This is something where you need to learn from practice and application of your knowledge rather than just trying to memorize this. So anyone, does anyone say that yes, this can be done? He can take stationery from his grocery and go. Can he do it? No one says yes, is it?
Yes.
What do you mean? Are you saying yes or no?
Yes.
Can be taken?
Yes.
Okay. So, how will you account for this?
Honest withdrawings.
on as with drawings. Very good. I think you might have already done some accounting. Okay, but that is the correct answer. You can't say that this person can't take it from here because it is his shop. He is the owner of this shop. So Mr. X is permitted to take anything from this business. There is no restriction for that. But what is the problem that we have here? How do we account for this? How do we account for this? That is the problem. That is the problem here. Why? The moment he gives 10 million into this business, this 10 million becomes what? That is called capital. 10 million is called the capital. So when you put capital into a business, it doesn't belong to anybody else. It is to the owners. It is to the owners. So who is the owner now? Mr. X. Now, if you are the owner, what you can take from this company is the profit that you may earn. If you earn a profit, that you can take. The company doesn't say anything. No problem. You can take the profit because it belongs to you. But taking goods like this from the company is cannot be done or not permitted. But if you still want to do it, if you still want to do it, how it should be considered is that you have taken something from this capital. So even though you have given 10 million, now you have taken out 7,000 rupees from that. Do you understand that point? Do you understand that point? You have given 10 million and now you are asking for 7,000 rupees. If you have taken this 7,000 rupees from the profit, I don't have an issue. That can be accounted. But the problem here is you are taking it in the form of goods. I can't allow you that. I need to account for it separately. That is what one student said. You have to account for it as a withdrawal of owner's equity. Withdrawal of owner's equity, whether it is 1,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees or 5 million, it doesn't matter. The moment you take it, that is a withdrawal of owner's equity. This we call it as, does anyone know what is the name? What is the name given for this?
Drawings.
Drawings, very good. We call it as drawings. We call it as drawings. So, why you need to account for it like this? Why you need to account for it like this is because the owner and the business are separate. That is why. You can't say the owner and the business is same. No. You have given 10 million and started this business. The moment you do that, that becomes the capital of the business. So you can't again come and take as and when you want money. No, that you can't do. If you do it, I will account for it as your drawings. Your drawings. So from where does this come? This is coming from the business entity concept. Do you understand that? Do you understand that? What does the business entity concept say? the owner and the business are two different. You can't take them as one. No, for accounting purposes, I can't do that. I have to consider the owner and the company as two different. So when you take something from the company, I will always treat that as your drawings. So here onwards, if I say drawings, then you should know what is that. What is that? Is a withdrawal of owner's equity. Okay, please take down the diagram quickly. Okay. So that is about the business entity concept. Business entity concept. I hope you would have understood that. Any questions? Anything that you want to clarify on this? Because here in after, when I say drawings, you should recall this. What do you mean by drawings? Okay, right. So we'll go to the next concept. We are done with the first one, right? So you can read this. Why? What is the significance of the concept? Let's go to the second one. This one is known as the money measurement concept. Money measurement concept. So I told you that any business, end of the day, you are worried about the performance. You are worried about the performance. So how do you measure your performance? In terms of money. In terms of money. How much of rupees and cents? How much of dollars, how much of sterling pounds, how much of euros, any currency you may call it, it doesn't matter. The performance of the company has to be measured in terms of money. In terms of money. So how you measure it in terms of money is using the currency of the country in which the business is run. In the country, the currency of the country in which the business is run. So in the case of Sri Lanka, you know that it is rupees, right? Now nobody is actually accounting for transaction in cents, but we normally go in rupees. So basically, rupees is the currency that you are going to use to evaluate performances. So what gives you that rationale to do it? It is from the money measurement concept. So what does it say? Assumes that all business transactions must be in terms of money that is in the currency of a country. In our country, such transactions are in terms of rupees. Now you can ask me a question. Does it mean that in Sri Lanka we don't have any rupee transactions other than rupees? Yes, we do have. We do have all the transactions other than rupees. But for financial reporting, end of the day, you have to consider everything in rupees. Okay? That is what this concept says. End of the day, you have to look at all these transactions in terms of rupees and cents. That is the currency of the country in which the business operates. Okay? That is about money measurement concept. You can read for yourself the significance. Let's go to the next one. Going concern. So this is very straightforward. Going concern means we prepare financial statements of a company assuming that this company is going to be there for the next unknown period. If a company is going to get closed in the next year, I won't prepare financial statements. No point. Because anyway, you are going to prepare it at the time of closing the business. But why I prepare financial statement is because I always assume that a company is going to run forever. There is no end for a company. So I assume that this company is going to run forever and I prepare accounts. Okay. So that is what it means. It means that every business entity has continuity of life. There is no end to it. Therefore, it will not be dissolved in the near future. Dissolve means you close down the business. No more business. No. We don't assume that a business is going to get closed and you prepare financial statements. No. If that is going to be closed down, I'm not very much interested in preparing financial statements now. I will prepare it later. And I'm closing it down. Right. So this, I might need time since we have already reached 5:30. We will stop it and I will continue this on Wednesday, as I mentioned to you, at 3:30. So I think IBSL would inform you all about this class during the week. So please join on Wednesday. We will continue this handout and then we'll, if time permits, we'll get on with other topics as well. Okay, see you all and take care.